Welcome to CVS Health Live, our ongoing series that delivers timely perspective and insights into leading healthcare issues happening now. Well, it is summertime, and it is June, and it is also Pride Month, one of the biggest celebrations of the LGBTQ community all year long. But it's not just about celebration. It's also about remembrance of loss, and also of recollection of progress that has been made and progress that still continues to be made. Today on CVS Health Live, we'll be talking about LGBTQ healthcare. Where have we been and where are we going? What disparities does this population face, and what are the end results of those disparities and the needs of this population? And what can we do as individuals to help support this community? My name is Melissa Price. I'm a Senior Manager of Customer Experience and Loyalty at CVS Health. And I'm the National Co-Leader for the Pride Plus Colleague Resource Group, serving the LGBTQ community and its allies. I'm really excited to be joined today with three superb experts in this field, and I'd like to introduce them to you now. Greg Jones is an Executive Director of Government Affairs and Public Policy with CVS Health. Shawnte Rothschild is a Senior Manager of Account Management and is a National Co-Leader for the Pride Plus Colleague Resource Group. And joining us from CenterLink, we have Deborah Levine, who is a Director of their LGBT YouthLink program. CenterLink, of course, being a national and international organization devoted to creating community spaces for driving progress at a local level for the LGBTQ community. Greg, Deborah, Shawnte, welcome to the program. I'm really looking forward to sharing some insights with you today. But first, Greg, I'd love to talk a little bit about the acronym LGBT. It can be LGBT, LGBTQIA, there could be plus signs, there could be a couple T's. It's really nebulous, and the acronym depends on who you actually ask. So could you tell us a little bit about that acronym, as well as what kinds of communities does it represent?
Absolutely. I mean, yes, I think the actual acronym, there's been an ever-changing landscape in sort of the alphabet soup of LGBT plus Q terminology. And I think for those of us who are actually in the community and our biggest allies, it's something that's often hard to keep up with. But that's okay. We appreciate everyone's support. But with respect to your question and what it means to me, the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer community is about a group of individuals who actually come from every single walk of life. And by that, I mean individuals with different religious backgrounds, different cultural backgrounds, different races. And not just within the U.S., but across the globe, we've got folks that are from the bluest, most progressive cities, and people who are raised in rural villages or small town America that like lean very conservative, and everything in between. So I think that diversity is really interesting, but I think there's one common bond that every member of this community understands and can relate to with respect to one another. And that is, at some point in our life, often in young adulthood, we each had that aha moment. And that moment was about, somehow I think I'm really different, or something is different, and that moment is, I'm different than my parents, I'm different than my siblings, I'm different than my cousins, I'm different than my aunts and uncles. And I think at that moment, when members of this community, it's you have that realization, it's really a pivotal time in your life, and it actually, the way you sort of navigate that journey from that point forward really will really impact like the rest of your life. But I think, like I said, we have a lot of diversity and people who come to this community with many different backgrounds. But I think to me, that's one of the bonds that tie us all together.
And I appreciate that perspective, Greg. It's a couple of terms that you mentioned in there was just diversity. And it reminds me of the additional term intersectionality. And Shawnte, I appreciate your reaction to some of what Greg said about that intersectionality and how it plays specifically in the Black and Brown communities, as well as other diversity communities. What is that topic? How does it contribute to disparities?
Thank you for that question, Melissa. As it relates to intersectionality, if you think about the many pieces of us, that is the connecting of those pieces. We are not one-dimensional. We as individual, we experience many things in life. We are born into experiences. We gain experiences and throughout our life. And so intersectionality, again, is the culminating, the mixing, the connecting of those pieces. And of course, those affect our experiences, the way that we perceive things, the way that we interact and feel things. Black and lesbian, transgender and disabled, just again, those different pieces that make up who we are. And with that, our Black and Brown community are members of all of those letters that Greg mentioned within our LGBTQ plus alphabet soup. We all have different lenses and we all intersect at different places. One thing that I would like to mention is that intersectionality, we often hear it associated with negative experiences because of things that we are discriminated against. But they often, it can often work the other way, meaning that in our community, we may be regarded and respected in this specific community, but outside of that community, our other experiences, those other pieces of us, give us a different experience. And so with that, maybe the example of cisgendered Asian CEO in that one space of their life, one piece of the block that connects. But on the other side of that, that same individual might experience some bullying on the internet or experience racial slurs or experience healthcare disparity. And so again, those two experiences are what causes that intersectionality. Those different pieces of them as an individual, they experience different things at different times. And so it's important that we as individuals, organizations, our government understand that intersectionality is important and that individuals' problems, just conversations, need to take that into account.
And Deborah, piggybacking off of what Shawnte talked about disparities and some of the impact that you see from an intersectional standpoint, I'd love to hear a little bit about what you are seeing from a local level with all of your community centers that you have in place throughout the nation and world. Do you have examples and what are you seeing from a disparity standpoint?
Yes, thank you. It is alarming. And I want to start just by saying, you know, and making clear that most sexual minority youth really are able to transition to adulthood successfully and become healthy and productive adults. Unfortunately, though, many of these issues that we're seeing in terms of mental health, and I'll dig into a little bit more, really we are seeing some significant disparities for lesbian, gay, and bisexual youth. And I do want to note that I'm just saying lesbian, gay, and bisexual because only recently and not yet consistently have we been collecting data on transgender youth. But the early data really just show that they are consistently also seeing these same disparities, if not worse, for the transgender youth. So some of the things we're seeing that are really detailed in reports from the CDC and the Youth Risk Behavior Survey that they've done are the mental health pieces. Lesbian, gay, and bisexual and questioning youth are much more likely to report feeling sad or hopeless than heterosexual youth. They're much more likely to have considered attempting suicide, to have made an attempt and to have actually attempted, to have made a plan and to have actually attempted. And then we also see disparities when it comes to trauma. LGBT youth have greater experience with trauma in many forms. They're more likely to have been threatened or injured with a weapon, to be in a physical fight, to be injured in a fight, to not go to school because of safety concerns, to be bullied, to be forced to have sexual intercourse, to experience sexual or dating violence. And that trauma really compounds mental health issues. And then the minority stress that the LGBTQ population experiences broadly, youth are experiencing as well. And so the stigma and discrimination that they experience in many areas of their lives, school, et cetera, really contributes to mental health issues, as well as use of substances and engaging in high-risk behaviors. And for youth in particular, when parents are so important, parents and other caregivers, the fact that parents may not support them and may even reject them can be really compound many of the issues and experiences they're having. And to top it off, because many of these behaviors that start during adolescence will continue into adulthood, they can potentially have a lifelong negative impact on folks' health outcomes, on their educational attainment, employment, housing, overall quality of life, which really continues to impact mental health throughout the lifespan.
So, Deborah, one of the terms that you threw out there was mental health and the impact that disparities have on the mental health of LGBTQ individuals. There was a study that was just released by the Trevor Project, of course, being one of the premier worldwide organizations tackling LGBTQ mental health and tackling the issue of suicide in the community. And this study stated that over the course of the pandemic, 42% of LGBTQ individuals, youth particularly, made a serious thought about having suicide, and 12 to 31%, depending on the community, actually made an actual attempt. Those levels are well elevated against the general U.S. population. I'm curious about what you're seeing specifically in mental health care, and what kinds of reaction do you have to those kinds of statistics that we're facing?
Absolutely. I echo what Shawnte and Greg said. For sure, these disparities are quite widespread. And there's a number of factors that really lead to that. The first is the difficulty of accessing health insurance. And this is partly due to disparities in employment and income. But we're seeing lower rates of health insurance across the board. And in particular, transgender people have even less access, and insurance might not cover what are life-saving treatments. Another factor here is the stigma and discrimination that folks can experience from healthcare providers. And ultimately, even if there are healthcare providers who are competent, there's not enough of them that are competent. There's a lack of access to those affirming healthcare providers. And the third piece of this is that we are in a constant fight against policies that would actually allow healthcare providers to refuse to provide care to LGBTQ patients, which is just alarming and not really where we need to be. All of these factors lead to what we're seeing, which is that many LGBTQ folks delay healthcare, and that, as we all know, is not good for anyone's health. Now, of course, there's also the broader picture of the stigma and discrimination that folks are experiencing in other areas of their lives, and this really contributes to higher rates of mental health issues, the use of substances including cigarettes, alcohol, and other drugs, as well as engaging in high-risk behaviors. All of these factors add up to LGBTQ people having lower health overall as a result of these barriers, and it can be really compounded for Black, Indigenous, and other people of color. And then to top it all off, there's a real inconsistency in the collection of data on sexual orientation and gender identity. So we don't even know what we don't know. There are truly significant gaps in our knowledge around this, but what we do know is that disparities exist.
And Deborah, you actually went a little bit beyond mental health. And so, Greg, I'd love to get your insights as well into this, maybe a little bit broader than mental health, but certainly mental health can have an impact on other dimensions of healthcare. Of course, there being physical health, emotional well-being, and all these different forms of healthcare. Could you talk a little bit about some of the things that we are seeing in the healthcare industry around that, those other dimensions of health for the LGBTQ community and some of those challenges?
Absolutely. And I agree with Deborah. I mean, I think the vast majority of individuals from the LGBTQ plus community transition to adulthood and become productive members of society. But we would be absolutely remiss if we were to ignore some of the mental health challenges that I've seen play out just in with my own personal network, including substance abuse, I think is qu- quite prevalent in our community. And I actually have a personal experience and story that is kind of one of the most powerful memories I have from my childhood. In fact, when I was 10 years old, my mom and I were actually getting ready to board a flight to Florida. And we had gotten a phone call right before we were about to leave about my older cousin. And at the time I was 10, he was in his 20s. He was raised with my older brother, so they always kind of played together as kids and all that kind of stuff. By that point, he had come out. We knew he was gay. He actually had gotten married, but that didn't work out with a woman. And then he moved out to California. His mother went out there to visit him. And after she left, within two weeks, he hung himself. So that was a pretty significant event in our family. I will never forget that moment. Obviously that was a very real life example of the intersection, I think, between mental health and, you know, the impacts that can have on the LGBT plus community. The other thing I'll just point out, this was in the 80s, so I'm sure there was a lot going on in his life, but he was also, you know, sort of navigating the AIDS epidemic at the time, which was, you know, rampant. So definitely something, an important issue to our community that we all need to be very mindful of.
Well, thank you so much, Greg. And I'm terribly sorry that was a terrible event that you had to experience very personally, and so sorry for the loss of a loved one. But thank you so much for the vulnerability and sharing that. I mean, it's important that we share these kinds of stories because there's real present impact. And Shawnte, I'd love to hear about some of the things that happen in the Black and Brown community that, you know, just reflect some of the challenges that, you know, Greg just spoke about. And you know, what are some of those unique challenges in the intersectional community?
Thank you, Greg, for sharing that story. It reminded me of how perceptions come about. So speaking about the Black, Brown, and Indigenous community, there is a lot of distrust as it relates to the medical field and seeking assistance. And so, Greg, I too remember quite a bit of stories growing up, hearing about study like the Tuskegee studies and things that made me and many people of color, those stories, that those memories of the things that have happened in the past and even as current as today, that make people that look like me question, should I get some assistance? You know, question, I need this help, but will I be assisted? You see so many studies of higher rates of women of color dying due to childbirth. You hear so many stories of even as late as several weeks ago, where a physician, a woman of color, lying in the hospital sharing her experiences as a physician, they're passing away of the discrimination that she received, again, as a person of color. So to see those real life accounts, which isn't history, which isn't a story, but that we are actually seeing now, that impacts people. That impacts our perception of, I need help, but will I be able to get it? I need assistance, but will I be discriminated against? Will my life be looked at as less than? It is very sad to even have to question that in this day and time. And so between those historic stories that we've read about, that we've heard about, to current day things that you see, people losing their life, George Floyd and many others in front of our eyes, that adds another lens, another layer of experience. And so when you are meeting with people, when you are interacting with people, that connection of their experiences based on their life, who they are, their world within that LGBT community, any world or community that they belong to, they present that, they experience that with every thing that they have. And so, as I mentioned, we are not one-dimensional. our experiences, our lives are very vast and different, and those differences play into how people experience and how they feel things as it relates to their mental and both physical health.
Thank you, Shawnte. I'd actually like to ask you one additional question, just real quick, get your reaction to that, because there are a lot of anecdotal stories out there, but one of the statistics that I just saw recently was that for Black transgender individuals, the homelessness rate is 5 times the standard United States population. Just real quick, does that to you, give some proof as to some of what you just talked about?
Thank you for sharing that statistic, Melissa. And again, so many things just about that one number resonate with me. It stands out to me. The fact that many have no family, no one to relate to, so they are turned to the street, and with that many times pick up unfortunate habits such as alcoholism. They are forced to be put in situations to where they are not safe. So many things go along with that homeless status. And with that too, many are afraid to ask for help for fear of retaliation or bad treatment from those that are in positions that are designed to help individuals. So again, that intersectionality, that combined experiences of that individual's life from their LGBTQ association, from that, possibly being thrown out of their home or not being accepted, possibly a lack of assistance with mental health needs and supports. And so, again, those statistics, while alarming, are not, is not something that I would question. And I would probably say that those numbers have increased since the time of that study, because with COVID, with the increase in mental health concerns, just like Greg, as you said, Melissa, we all have stories that we can share. But I too many times have I experienced, been a part, or have had people reach out to me for help. And their question is, will I be assisted? Will I be seen for me? Not for this, not for that, but for me as an individual, and will my needs be met? And that for me is a very, very sad thing to have to consider as a parent, as a community member, as a proud queer woman of color, that in 2021, those are things that people still have to face when we have so many resources available.
Thank you for that reaction there, Shawnte. Obviously, a lot of work to be done. But Deborah, I'd love to turn things over to you. Hear a little bit more about CenterLink and how you all are locally, through your community centers, tackling some of these challenges that the LGBTQ community is currently facing.
Sure. Thank you. Well, I think I want to jump off of something that Shawnte just said in terms of people feeling like they can't get services that affirm who they are. And that's really what our membership is doing. We have 270 plus LGBTQ centers throughout the country, Canada, and beyond. And CenterLink's mission is to strengthen, support, and connect those community centers. And we play an essential role in supporting their growth. But I'd love to speak really about what they are doing in their local communities. They are addressing these challenges on many fronts. And really one of the key pieces is they provide services that other organizations in town might provide, but they're doing so in an affirming way, in a way that really lets the LGBTQ individual and the community know that they are a whole person and they will be treated as a whole person. So looking at healthcare specifically, of our 270 centers, 49% are offering physical health services and 67% offer mental health services. In addition, they provide recreational activities, arts and culture programs, education programs. They address legal needs, as well as basic needs such as food pantries, housing, case management, and direct cash assistance. And every week, nearly 60,000 individuals are served by LGBTQ centers, and roughly 25,000 are referred to other agencies for services and assistance. And that's another piece of what the LGBT centers are doing, is they're working with their community partners to make sure those partners are affirming as well. The entire community, everything it should be, we should all be affirming in every instance of our lives, but we know that's not the reality today. So the centers are really working to help other organizations provide culturally competent services and programs. two other things just to mention is that we also really are working in collaboration. The centers work together to do a variety of things that one center alone couldn't. So for example, we have a digital program called Q Chat Space that provides online support for LGBTQ teens. And then the last piece that we do is we need to make sure that we fight to ensure that institutions and the government are enacting policies and laws that really support the community. And currently, that means to pass the Equality Act to fight against the many, many anti-trans bills we're seeing at the state level.
So that is a good segue, Greg, to you. You know, you deal with the federal state of affairs. You see all of the action in Washington, D.C., and so I'm curious about, on Deborah's point, we've seen a lot of progress. What is that progress? And what progress still needs to be made? What gaps still need to be served in creating public policy for the LGBTQ community as it pertains to healthcare solutions?
Sure. No, thank you for that question, Melissa. Right now, we're dealing with a very interesting situation because we have a stark contrast as to what is happening at the federal level versus what's occurring across many states across the country. Positively, at the federal level, the Biden-Harris administration is probably one of the biggest supporters of the LGBTQ plus community in the history of this country. Within 24 hours of coming into office, the Biden-Harris administration issued a comprehensive executive order to prevent and combat discrimination on the basis of gender identity, sexual orientation, and in this included reversing the Trump administration ban on allowing transgender individuals to serve in the military. The administration is also laser focused on addressing health disparities more broadly. I think a lot of this with the pandemic has highlighted the need to really be looking at the disproportionate impact the pandemic had on people of color. But the administration is also kind of looking at that looking at health disparities through the LGBTQ plus communities lens. And in fact, 2 weeks ago, the head of minority health at the Centers for Medicare and Medicare Services, which is the chief regulator of our company, held a listening session. And literally, this is a doctor who works for CMS, and she just had like a kickoff session where she kind of introduced herself, kind of talked about their goals, and really listened to a broad range of stakeholders from across the whole country talk about healthcare access issues, vaccination challenges, and all sorts of issues, all through the lens of the LGBTQ plus community. However, at the state level, we have a number of states that are either enacting legislation or attempting to enact legislation, and most often that is anti-LGBTQ plus legislation targeting the transgender community. I think this is a really unfortunate situation. So I think if there's work that needs to be done, it's really to be like kind of working at the state level to combat these efforts.
Well, thank you, Greg, for that answer. And so we have the community level, we have the government level. Shawnte, I'd love your perspective for CVS Health and the corporate level. What have you seen as far as CVS Health tackling and solving for equity issues in LGBTQ healthcare? Could you share a little bit about that?
Gladly, Melissa. So I'd first like to start with just defining health equity, because you hear equality, equity all of the time. And so in its simplest form, what I'd like to say, it means increasing the opportunities for everyone equally to experience a healthy, happy life, no matter what they look like, being able to show up as their authentic self, no matter where they are or their experiences. And so with that, I am very proud to just highlight some of the things that CVS has done in that space. First thing that comes to mind is Project Initiative, Project Health, excuse me, which is an initiative where we at CVS offer biometric screenings with no insurance required. And so we hear of discounts and different things, but no insurance required for this particular program, and it is literally offering screenings that help identify chronic conditions before they become life-threatening illnesses. So many times we see people in marginalized communities, you hear of stories of people showing up at the emergency room and being diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, these different things. But by being proactive and offering these screenings, these early detective screenings, that is what helps people be given the opportunity to live that happy, healthy life. In addition, from an employee perspective, we have resource groups, colleague resource or business resource groups that allow us individuals, whatever your affinity, to come together and really focus on not only your professional and personal development, but your mental health as well. And so as an employee, of course, we have robust benefits to assist us in living those long, healthy lives. But in addition to assisting employees and providing those resources and our project initiatives where we are doing the biometric screenings, we work with our clients to really identify what their needs are so that we are providing benefits for their employees, for the community that are going to meet those needs as individuals to do away with those healthcare disparities. In addition to those things, we offer a variety of services. We meet people where they are. So whether it's face-to-face services, whether it's walking into one of our over 100,000 minute clinics for face-to-face interaction, or our telehealth services that we offer, our partners as well offer these services, again, to meet people in the community where they are.
Thank you for that response, Shawnte. I'd like to shift gears to what we can do as individuals, which is really, you know, the part of this conversation I've been so looking forward to sharing with you all. So, Deborah, I'd like to start with you. We're starting to exit the pandemic. We have some more work to do, obviously, with driving COVID-19 down, but we're starting to make that exit. And so we've seen through the Trevor Project some of the situations that have been created for LGBTQ youth being vulnerable as they are. What advice could you give adults and communities to support that area of our population?
Absolutely. It's a great question. I think it's really important for us to each consider what we do on the individual level. And certainly LGBTQ youth have experienced the pandemic and had greater, worse outcomes, but it's not really different than what we were doing before. We just need to do more of it and do it better. And I would say there's a number of things really to do that. The first is really to encourage respect for all youth. Don't allow bullying, harassment, or violence against any youth. And that would be verbal and physical. For example, research shows that for trans youth, use of their chosen name and their pronouns, that alone has a huge positive impact on their well-being. So any adult can really be respectful of those pieces. Identifying and developing safe spaces at schools, in social service organizations, in the community where sexual minority youth can get to and get support from trusted adults. Those are key. That could be libraries or coffee shops, community-based organizations, the Y. There are many places where youth might gather, and making sure those are safe. And then in those spaces, really encouraging youth-led and youth-organized clubs and opportunities that really promotes the connectedness and a safe, welcoming, and accepting environment. When they're in school or in conversations with parents and other trusted adults, when it comes to health and sexual health and any kind of health, really making sure that those materials and those conversations are inclusive of sexual minority youth, use inclusive terms and language. And if you don't know as an adult, ask someone. Resources are out there. Go online so that you can be that trusted adult for these teens. And then also advocating for professional development opportunities. You know, most adults are well-meaning and want to help, but they don't know what to do. And if they're in a professional setting where they interact with youth, really making sure that those schools, community organizations, religious organizations, healthcare settings, that they get professional development trainings that can encourage them how to create safe and supportive environments. And then making it easier for youth to have access to community-based healthcare providers. That would be, and of course, ones who are affirming, that could be bringing them to their schools, advocating for that, or other locations where youth can easily access them. And lastly, really promoting parental engagement. Some of us are parents, and as parents, we can do all this work. Those of us who aren't parents and those of us who are parents but are in another setting, really engaging parents, because parents can be key really to helping adolescents. Those are the things I'd recommend. We are doing them and we need to do more of them.
Shawnte, slightly different question for you. Working for CVS Health, you've seen a lot of things happen, surely, for CVS Health colleagues, employees. What would you recommend to anyone who is an employer listening in today that is interested in doing something more for their LGBTQ employees?
That is a great question, Melissa. Thank you for that. I would first start by recommending that organizations put on an intersectional lens, looking at the individuals, at your employees, as multidimensional, again, putting it into practice. So realizing that there are multiple facets to individuals and the experiences that they've had thus far and how that shapes their perception and their individual needs. Additionally, putting it into practice. So words are nice, but it is the practice that makes perfect, right? We often hear that. And so with that, taking every opportunity to ensure that your employees, that the community is aware that of the opportunities, is aware that people are not only asked, but invited to show up as their authentic self. Again, realizing that authentic self, that experience, that life, it is made up of many components. Making room, Deborah mentioned inviting youth, but inviting your employees, those from the community, to come in and speak and share their experiences, to let everyone know that they are welcome and that those experiences are valued. And I would say, lastly, ensuring that there is a place at the table. So as an employer, when you say all are welcome, again, putting that into practice and showing that by encouraging, asking, soliciting feedback from all within your organization with the multitude of experiences and lenses that they bring, to ensure that the decisions reflect everyone, that it is not something that is just good for one, but good from everyone. And you get that by encouraging and inviting feedback from all those within your organization, both up and down.
Oh, great insights there, Shawnte. Greg, I'd like to get some final thoughts from you. We've heard a little bit about the employer space. We've heard a little bit about how we can support youth exiting the pandemic. But let's talk about societal level healthcare. And, you know, I've heard that one person's healthcare can impact other people's as well. You know, all healthcare is local. All healthcare is also interlinked. Why should we prioritize other people's healthcare? Why should we, you know, advocate for LGBTQ healthcare? And are there any impacts that you could see downstream positively at a societal level for doing so?
Absolutely. Yeah. And as you mentioned earlier, I do live here in Washington, D.C., and that gives me the fortunate opportunity to actually go down to the National Mall anytime I want. And the other day I was riding my bike and I stumbled across this quote and from one of my favorite presidents and also FDR. And if you have not seen his monument, if you're here in town, I recommend you go see it, because it is quite a substantial monument. It has one section dedicated to each of his four terms with these very powerful quotes throughout. But one of them says, "We must scrupulously guard the civil rights and civil liberties of all citizens, whatever their background. We must remember that any oppression, any injustice, any hatred is a wedge designed to attack our civilization." And I think it's interesting that in this quote, he uses the term wedge. And I mentioned some of these anti-LGBTQ plus pieces of legislation being put forward across many state legislatures. I think that is very unfortunate. And I actually think that the motivation behind many of those pieces of legislation, honestly, is to create a wedge in our society. And it's to create, you know, target transgender individuals who, you know, recognizing that there are others in society that may be uncomfortable with that population, or they're kind of creating like issues with like these, like the sports teams and athletes and who's playing on what team. And in the reality, at the end of the day, we're all human. And I think we need to recognize that. And I would ask that, you know, anyone who's watching this program, just kind of keep that in mind. And not just fall into this trap of like with of these wedge issues that are kind of being used to really kind of gin up people for votes or politics or whatever you want to call it. Because at the end of the day, I think what a lot of those pieces of legislation are doing are targeting the transgender community. But actually, importantly, from where we're, you know, based on this panel discussion we're having today, can create an access issue to healthcare. And those are issues that really should be dealt with at the local level between the patient, the parents, and the providers, and others that need to be involved in those personal decisions.
Well, thank you for that, Greg. That I don't think we could end much higher than quoting FDR here and talking about seeing people as individuals. The LGBTQ community does need help. I'd like to end personally on a story that I just saw from Olympian Gus Kenworthy, who is involved in Olympic skiing. And in 2018, he partnered with Procter & Gamble to produce a campaign that where he talked about his authenticity in being an out public gay male. And as part of that campaign, someone wrote P&G and actually said, thank you for saving another soul. And so as we think about things from a societal standpoint, you know, it's important to think about, you know, quotes like that. And if you're hearing things like that, you are making progress, and let's make progress together. I want to thank our esteemed guests here for joining us and sharing your insights, your expertise, and certainly some of your enthusiasm behind this really important healthcare topic. Thank you, Greg, Shawnte, Deborah, for joining the program today. If you are interested in learning more about this topic, you can check out CenterLink's website at www.lgbtcenters.org. And to find a local community center in your area, you just need to add a /LGBTCenters to that website address. If you're interested in helping out LGBTQ teens, you can find at their qchatspace.org. They'll be able to find community as well as the potential for new friendships as well. My name's Melissa Price. Thank you so much for spending a little bit of your time with us today, and we will look forward to seeing you again soon for our next episode of CVS Health Live. Until then, here's to our collective health. Take care.